kind of man who still supposed to be proven or those kind of things. So there's dependencies on that, absolutely.
I mean, you know, you can always include the proviso that further information would be provided at the meeting, that sort of thing. So I'm conscious that there wouldn't have been, or there is no public record of that presentation now. I think, you know, ordinarily it would be printed in the agenda and members of the public would see it. So there's an issue around that as well.
Yeah.
Okay, so there are a few things there. I think if we know the report, and we also had to, we've heard a few times about acronyms, so if we factor that into the training and we can all get a copy of the Longmans family directed to the Children's Families Department.
We're trying to stop writing
it
now, we're trying to
do a glossary. Yeah, absolutely.
Sorry.
And if we can agree in principle to meet with the care leaders council as a committee as well, I think that'd be really, really useful if we all agree on that.
Agreed.
Okay, moving on to item six, we have an implications sort of report by David Robbins, who's the manager of the Rural Safeguard and Children Board, around the Children's Social Work Act. On the 23rd of August, we had a workshop which was to explore our relationship, our working relationship with the board. We discussed legislation which is coming up in the future that would affect the statutory arrangements of the board. We agreed that it would be useful if they came and spoke to us in detail about what those arrangements would mean for the future of the board.
Thank you very much, Chair. What you've got in your pack is quite a short report, but a concise summary of an aspect of legislation which went through Parliament and Chief Royal Estate in April of this year called the Children's Social Work Act. Now, this went through Parliament just before Purdah for the general election, and what typically happens with legislation that goes through at that time is it doesn't come through with much guidance around implementation, so that is guidance which we are awaiting. But I'll give you a summary of how that act will affect safeguarding boards going forward. So the Children and Social Work Act, it was introduced to make three central provisions in relation to children. There's a provision around children who are looked after, there's a provision in relation to the welfare of children, and there's provision about the regulation of social workers. As well as those central provisions, the Act also introduced changes which have implications for local safeguarding and children boards. As you will be aware, safeguarding boards were established through the 2004 Children Act to ensure agencies work together to safeguard children, and perhaps more importantly, to test the effectiveness of those safeguarding arrangements. They are the only statutory bodies with this remit. Safeguarding boards do this in a variety of ways, including having a big board which is made up of senior strategic managers from across the local authority and all of our partner agencies. They undertake other activities such as the publication of all the safeguarding policies and procedures. They undertake audits, quality assurance and scrutiny activity. And they provide multi-agency safeguarding training, and they have some other statutory responsibilities in relation to the undertaking of serious case reviews and other reviews. In 2015, the government commissioned Alan Wood, who's the Director of Children's Services, to lead a review of the roles and functions of safeguarding boards. The report was presented to ministers in May 2016 and made 34 recommendations, the chief of which was the proposal to replace the existing framework for LSCBs with a new statutory framework. That recommendation was accepted and has been included in the Children and Social Work Act. So in effect, it signals the end of the current LSCB structure. The Act received Royal Assent in April this year, and there are three main parts of the Act relevant to that safeguarding structure, one of which is replacement of serious case reviews, creating new local safeguarding arrangements, and reforming child death overview panels. child death is a statutory requirement of safeguarding, or whenever a child dies, that has to be reviewed by the local safeguarding children's court. So more detail on each of those is provided in your report. But in summary, for case reviews, the government will replace the current national panel. There is a national panel which sits in London, and it's their responsibility to scrutinise the decision of LSCBs about whether to undertake a serious case review or not. So that panel is going to be stood down, and there's going to be a new safeguarding practice review panel. It's going to be a new set of reviews called Serious Child Safeguarding Cases, and those will be reviewed under the supervision of this new panel. Obviously, that includes the appointment of reviewers. Again, we don't know precisely what that is going to look like because we are awaiting the statutory guidance. The Act also makes provision for local areas to undertake their own local child safeguarding practice reviews, which do not meet the serious case review threshold. We have something similar already in place. For the new safeguarding requirements, the Act removes the requirement to have a safeguarding board, but introduces the requirement to have robust local arrangements in place. Responsibility for those arrangements falls to the three statutory safeguarding partners. So these are the three partners who will take on the responsibility for establishing these safeguarding arrangements currently undertaken through safeguarding boards. One of which is the local authority, one of which is Merseyside Police, and one of which is the Wirral Clinical Commissioning Group. So local authority, police and health are going to be the three key members. The current responsibilities of LSCBs will fall to these partners, who must agree and decide how relevant agencies will work together to safeguard and promote the welfare of children. This includes agreeing how such arrangements will be resourced and funded. And unlike LSCBs, which sit over single local authority footprints, the Act makes provision for these arrangements to be done across wider footprints. Now, it remains to be seen what the appetite in Wirral amongst the three partners is. We're entering into wider arrangements, but you could, for example, have a Merseyside ward. So these are things which this committee and the local authority and the current safeguarding board need to consider, because we will have to frame these arrangements going forward. In terms of child death reviews, these are going to sit under the responsibility of the local authority and the Wirral CCG. It makes sense for child death reviews to sit under health, because the vast majority of child deaths, there are no safeguarding issues around the deaths of those children. So it's always been a slightly uncomfortable fit with safeguarding children boards. So I think that has been reflected in the new legislation. For the implementation of the Act, one of the more curious aspects, especially in regard to safeguarding, is the current lack of guidance or an implementation timetable. The implementation of the Act is the responsibility of the Department for Education. We believe that they will publish revised statutory guidance and perhaps guidance for transition from boards to the new arrangements in the autumn of this year. And we also believe that the aim will be for new arrangements to be in place by March 2019. So we'll probably have a year and a bit of transitional arrangements. But this is all subject to confirmation. The Safeguarding Board has already requested that the partnership consider how it wants local arrangements to be shaped, and the Safeguarding Board is holding a workshop to that effect in November. The recommendations made to this committee from this report are to be aware of the planned changes to the Safeguarding Board and to participate in the consultations. When the guidance comes out, it usually comes out with a 12-week consultation. It is very important that where all the local authority and our partners do participate in that consultation, so we can help shape what the new arrangements will be. Once we know the new arrangements, we'll be very happy for the chair to come back to the scrutiny committee so we can confirm what the arrangements will like going forward. So I appreciate that's quite a brief report, and I hope it provides the committee with the information that you require. I'm happy to take any questions.
Any questions on this? I have a sort of suspicion. It's more they grew out of multiple sort of tragedies, really, and we're moving from quite a well-defined arrangement to something that, to quite a vague arrangement, which we're not really sure how it will look yet.
I think significant bodies such as the Association of Independent LSEP Chairs are lobbying government almost on a daily basis and saying you're making it very difficult for local areas to move forward without further statutory guidance. So in November there is a conference that the Independent Chairs hold, and they have invited the DfE to come with that guidance to that conference. We understand that they are going to publish some transitional arrangements, but at the moment we all do feel a little bit out of the loop. The act has gone through Parliament, it is going to be implemented, we're just not sure when and how. But until those arrangements are in place, I should assure the committee that the current arrangements remain, safeguarding laws remains, all the statutory arrangements remain. The only thing that I would say that the committee and the local authority and the partners need to look out for is the revised statutory guidance, which will come out at some point in the autumn. Through our current arrangements, we would never allow there to be any period of uncertainty, which is why the partnership will retain the current statutory arrangements until we know that they are going to be replaced with something equally robust. We are very confident that there will be a transitionary period, so we're likely to get the new guidance in the autumn. We will put transitionary arrangements in place looking from March 2018, but they will still be under our current statutory responsibilities, and the new arrangements won't come into effect until March 2019. But by that time, everybody will have had an opportunity to scrutinise those arrangements.
Chair, not totally a question. Understanding it's a very difficult time when you're living through change, isn't it? And it's unsettling to know what's what and how it will pan out and how it will work. I read a recent comment in the Nursery World, actually, where a chair of one local Snow Barley Children's Board was actually welcoming the changes. As almost maybe as reassurance, the system isn't totally fixed or totally right, because we have that I can just think of at the moment off the top of my head. I can think of the case of Daniel Pelka that happened in the Safeguard Children Board arena, and various other children that I can think of where terrible things have happened. So we all have to keep striving to make it better and better. And that's, I'm sure, what everybody wants to do.
I think it's a good point to make that we are always striving to improve the arrangements that are in place, and the Safeguard and Children Board would never advocate such standards there.
Feedback from the Safeguard, but I believe that the Safeguard Board met
this afternoon.
So, the Royal Safe Guard Children's Board workshop on the 23rd of August was to gain a sense of a better understanding of what the board did, and to draft a working document between scrutiny and the board, so that we have a better and more clearly defined working relationship, which was something that was lacking in the usual. So the draft protocol is in the pack, so if you've got any comments, questions or recommendations, that's great. I'll just come back David for some feedback from the safeguarding.
So we presented the draft protocol to the safeguarding board executive a few weeks ago, and it was reported in the minutes that the protocol was wholeheartedly endorsed. I was further endorsed by the safeguarding board meeting this afternoon. The main comment that came out of the safeguarding board executive was combining and aligning our scrutiny programme makes complete sense, and we should be able to achieve some economies of scale, and the safeguarding board are looking forward to being able to work with the scrutiny committee. So it was unanimously accepted.
That sounds entirely positive, which is refreshing. I think as well we were informed of a couple of interesting areas to look at on the work programme, and what came from members during the workshop was that we wanted an item on the HIGH, specifically around their outreach work and a report on the employment prospects for care leavers. So I would recommend that the committee approve the draft protocol if everyone's who wants to do so without any further recommendations to it, that we add those two items to the work program as well. Does everyone agree? So now we're going to move there to order.
The response I had when the book heads was the test was harder. And I appreciate the test was harder, but it was harder for all the children, which you might talk back. So I'm probably not very popular at the moment, but we do need to look at that. And in terms of phonics, we need to make sure that those children that are now going into year two have got appropriate teaching and learning to catch up, because they will be resitting the phonics test in the summer. So in terms of the report, I was just going to briefly go over the executive summary, and I'm happy to take questions from elected members. In terms of the early years, we're still in a situation where our girls do better than the boys, but we have had some improvements in the boys, which was great, but at the detriment of the girls. So the boys have gone up and the girls have gone down slightly. What we wanted was the boys to accelerate at a greater rate than the girls still to improve. We had more children looked after attain a good level of development. The gap between, we look at the gap of what all pupils do and how our children are looked after do, because what we want to do is to close that gap. It's roughly the same, so there's still work to be done there, and again, focus for development and scrutiny for us going into schools is how those young children, those looked after children are doing in year one, and how they, what their phonics outcomes as one of the measures will be. English as an additional language has decreased year on year for the last 3 years. The attainment of black minority ethnic children has remained the same. We tend to find, as you would probably expect, that children, where they have English as an additional language, their GLD outcomes, particularly in communication and language and literacy, aren't high. They catch up, they actually accelerate, and normally when they enter key stage two, they achieve better than their peers. So we know that the work that's done, and actually our English as an additional language children tend to do very well at phonics, and part of that is the way that they're taught English. So we are more aware of that with one or two concerned. More children with SEN, special educational needs, achieve a good level of development. They're the children that don't have education, health and care plans. So that's about 3%. We have looked at the autumn, spring and summer birthdays. And it's really probably what you'd expect. The autumn children tend to do better than the spring, they tend to do better than the summer. But this year there has been a dip in terms of the percentage of autumn birth children that met the standard for GLD. Free school meal gap unfortunately has widened. And that's because the non-free school meal children's attainment went up slightly, the free school meal went down, so the gap widened. What we've also done this year is we've shared all the information about localities, and this really is to it raises more questions than answers really, but it helps us drill down and see what's going on in localities. The word of caution there when we're looking at localities is it's the school data that we're looking at and not where the children live. And that can be significantly different. So for some of our primary schools, there'll only be 50% of children living in the catchment area. They come from a variety of catchments. So it's just a note of caution on that one. In terms of the good levels of development as well, there were a few anomalies. We had some schools that went from around 75-80% good level of development down to between 30-45%. So there are questions being raised as to why that's the case. And these were not in our downtown Birkenhead schools or Seacombe schools, these were in West Wirral. So we need to have a look and find out what the issues are pertaining to that. We also had, I don't think we've ever had a school that's got 11.1% good level of development. Although I haven't named that school, that head teacher knows who we were, it was on the PowerPoint yesterday, because I just need to have raised the accountability there. It was a very small cohort of children as well. So, and the school also took children in from the vulnerable 2-year-olds. So the question I'm raising there is, what value added are we getting in that setter. In terms of the phonics, we did again. We had some really strange results, and I've just highlighted one there. One school went from 88% to 28%. That is very unusual to have such a change. So again, there's more questions being asked, and this is being taken back through the locality boards to provide support for these schools that need it, but also a challenge to say what are the lessons learnt, and also to match schools where the outcomes have been good from a similar catchment or background and say, this school's done it, let's look at the good work there and see whether that school can learn from it. At key stage two, when the results came in, initially I was skipping around thinking, yes, we've made some great improvement. The issue was that so did most local authorities nationally. So we had an improvement of 4%, but we still remain below the national average. The gap is narrowing. The key message really at key stage one and key stage two is we are not getting the children through achieving the expected standard in all three areas, in reading and writing and maths. There's a real anomaly, and that's something, again, we put back to the schools and said, you know, can we look at the tracking systems you're using? Because if what used to happen, or should happen, is whatever the lowest outcome is, so for an example in a school, if they got 50% in reading, 40% in writing, and 60% in maths, the combined, the children should get in reading and writing and maths should be the lowest one, 40%. And in a significant number of our schools, it's well below. So we've got a mismatch of some children getting 2 out of 3, or 1 out of 3, not necessarily 3 out of 3, and that's the same key stage one and key stage two. More children, Gaffender did better in reading. It's still not where we'd like it to be. But the attainment gap between them and all pupils has widened. The gender gap has narrowed in reading and writing because the boys did better, and that's a real success story. Because if you remember this time last year, I was saying if you were a boy in rural, you, from the age of 4, you were actually starting at a low baseline because your achievement wasn't the same as the girls. So that's good news for the boys. Again, in reading, writing, maths, the autumn born pupils outperformed those born in the spring and the summer. All localities saw improvements on the number of pupils achieving the expected standard in reading and writing and maths, but it's not where we want it to be. And the more disadvantaged children and non-disadvantaged children at the standard. Key stage two, we saw an increase of 8% in the percentage of children that were reading and writing and maths. And again, I was very excited until I saw what had happened nationally. So we are still below the national average by 4%. More children looked after attain the expected standard this year. For children looked after, the progress measures are really good. So what we're seeing is that the children looked after from key stage one to key stage two, even if their attainment's below the national average, the progress they make is better than expected. So we're closing the gap for the free school meal, for the looked after children. And then I've basically done an analysis really of how we've done in reading, writing, and maths in each of the different areas. And as you see, there's line graphs, tables, and many graphs. So I'm happy to take questions if anybody would like to ask me.
Thanks for the presentation, sir. It's always fascinating reading as you read these statistics. I was going to ask how they actually use the, you know, especially where there are underperformances, but you do say you share the information with their teachers. So I suppose, what do they do? I mean, are we